Welcome again. Today we would start with NCERT class 7th, the third chapter. Now this chapter focuses on fiber to fabric. We have to make one thing very clear that we can obtain fiber from both plant as well as animal. However, this chapter we would focus only on the fibers that are obtained or the fabric that is obtained from animals. So our focus today would be silk and wool, the two fabrics. But from plant also we get cotton, and that is a kind of plant fiber. That's a fiber that is derived from plant. That won't be discussed today. So today we would be focusing on silk and wool. So we have a simple sample of silk and a sample of wool. In class 6th, we have seen the experiments where we have tried to find out the difference between an artificial fiber and a natural fiber. So if you remember, what was the difference? I'll just give a brief recall of it. So what we did was, we did an experiment where we burnt the two fibers. One was artificial, that's nylon, and another was natural, be it cotton or silk. And we saw the difference between the two fibers after burning. So after burning, this artificial fiber converts into a kind of ball that cannot be further broken down or dismantled. However, this natural fiber could be easily dismantled or separated out into smaller particles. So that's a very basic or a fundamental for starting this class. Now coming on to the first topic for today, that is silk and wool. So under that we would first cover wool. Now wool can be obtained from numerous animals. The most common that you might have heard of is sheep. But besides sheep, you have other animals from which you can obtain wool. A good example would be if you move down to a continent of South America. So let me draw a quick map here. And you would have a good idea to understand where all you have, what all kind of animals that are present. So if I move on to the region of South America, you have alpaca and llama. Now both of these, you have the wool that is derived. If I move to the colder areas, you have yak. So all the cold areas, the highlands, the tops of the mountains, high in latitude, you would have, and altitude as well, you would have yak. In India, if we say, you have the region of Ladakh, where you have numerous yak that could be seen. Again, in the region of Jammu Kashmir, you would have goat. Now, the goat which is popular is known as Angora goat, and from this Angora goat you have a fiber which is known as mohair. Very important thing to remember, you also have Angora wool. Now wool from the Angora goat is known as mohair, but wool from the Angora rabbit is known as Angora wool. So remember the difference. So Angora is the name of goat as well as rabbit. Angora goat gives the wool which is known as mohair. Angora rabbit gives the wool which is known as Angora. So that's again very, very important. Then you have in the colder areas camels, like in the regions of Ladakh again, you have camels, and these camels you have the wool that is derived. A very important animal from which you get wool so far was Chiru. However, this has been recently banned. Chiru is also known as Tibetan antelope, found in mainly in the parts of Kashmir, and the wool that is obtained from Chiru is known as shatush wool. So this shatush wool, when you are trying to obtain this wool, the only mechanism is to kill Chiru, and because of that, this shatush wool has been banned, and killing of this animal Chiru has been banned in India. So that's again important. Now how do we get the fiber, and how do we convert that fiber into a cloth or a woolen material? Now you have, let's say, a body of sheep here, or a sheep here. Now this sheep has the hairs. Now these hairs could be of two types. First is the coarse hair, and the other is the fine hair. Whenever we are talking about obtaining the wool, we only talk about the underlying fine hairs, and these fine hairs are shaved off. Now sheep are commonly seen in the areas of Jammu Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh, Uttaranchal, Arunachal Pradesh. So those are the hilly areas among the plains you have in the regions of Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan and Gujarat. Now all these areas where you have sheep rearing that is done, you have various varieties of the sheep. Some have coarse hairs as well as fine hairs. Other have simply fine hairs and the under hairs, what we call as. Now this fine hair which is used for the production of wool and the production of the woolen material is important, and we would understand how this process works off. Before that, we will be talking about some important varieties of wool or sheep, sorry, that are into existence. So the first is Lohi, found in Rajasthan and Punjab. Rampur Busher in the regions of UP in Himachal Pradesh. Then you have certain tribes like you have Bakkarwals. So those are the tribes, those are nomadic and they do the practice of transhumance as we have seen in the classes on social studies. So what they do is they move from the lowland to the highland based on the season, and they thrive by moving up and down on the mountain, and this practice is known as transhumance. So this transhumance is practiced by numerous nomadic tribes, and these nomadic tribes are the ones which carry sheep as one of the major animals along with them. Now another important species is Nalli. Nalli, you have the carpet wool that is made. Now there is the difference between the wool. One wool is for the carpet and the other is for shawls and sweaters. So that is obtained from Bakkarwal. So that's what we told. Bakkarwal is again a name of a tribe, and these are found mainly in the Jammu Kashmir. Similarly to Bakkarwal, you have Gaddis in Himachal Pradesh. And Nalli is mainly found in the lowland areas of Rajasthan, Haryana and Punjab. Now coming on to how this process of rearing is done and process of creation of woolen shawls or woolen sweaters is done. The first process that is involved is shearing. So when we say shearing, what it means, the uppermost layer or the layers or the hairs of the sheep are removed by shaving them out, and that process is known as shearing. Now after shearing, you have a process of scoring. This process could be manual or by machines. So what happens is the hairs are boiled to remove all the kind of dirt and the sticky material around them, and finally you have the clean hair that comes out. So that's the second process, which is known as scoring. Now whenever we are talking about these processes, our ultimate objective is to obtain wool, but here again the quality of the wool is very, very important. So when we say quality of the wool, how can we enhance this quality? This quality can be further enhanced by a process which is known as selective breeding. What is done under selective breeding is, let's say you have a breed of sheep which is having a very fine hair, the other breed of sheep which is having a very dense hair. Now you want a sheep variety which has both fine hair but are dense or have a good quantity. So you would cross these, that means a breeding of these two varieties would be done to find or to form an animal which would have fine and dense hair. So the quality of the hairs would be fine, but it would be more dense, so higher quantity could be obtained. So after that, the next important thing is you have done shearing, then you have done scoring. Now the next important thing is sorting out. So after scoring, what you do is you sort out. That means you remove all the kind of impurities that are there and you sort out different types of wool based on the texture. So based on the texture, you are separating the good quality and the other quality wool. Once the sorting is done, you try to pick it out. So after sorting is picking. So under picking, what you do is small burrs or the small, if you look onto this, you would have over the years, if you wash it constantly, you would have small white rolls that would come onto the sweater, and those are burrs. So all those kinds of impurities or burrs are removed by hand. So it is a kind of labor intensive job which involves manual picking. After that, you would have coloring of the shawls or the woolen material that is produced, the original colors are only three: black, brown and white. If you want any other color, you would have to dye it. So dyeing takes place, and finally rolling, where longer fibers are converted into sweaters and shorter fibers are converted into wool rolls. So those are the processes that takes place. However, this whole process of rearing the sheep and creating wool is having some hazard. So any occupation that is there, which is working with some specific concept, would have a certain hazard, and that is known as occupational hazard. So let's say a person working in coal mine would have an hazard of pneumonocosis. That means his lungs would be affected by the coal. Similarly, a person working with the sheep has an occupational hazard of carrying a disease which is known as anthrax. Now this anthrax is spread by bacteria, and it is basically, it affects the blood, and it's also known as blood disease or Sauter's disease. The next important fabric that we would discuss today is silk. Now when we talk about silk, is let's talk about the evolution or the history of silk. So silk originated initially in the regions of China. So what happened in Chinese peninsula, or the Chinese region, was, Chinese territory was, you had an emperor, Huang Ti. This emperor saw that the mulberry leaves, or the garden that it had, had some of the leaves that was damaged, and there were white marks on those leaves. Now he asked his fellow person why this was there, and finally they discovered the cocoons, and they saw fine thread of silk that could be obtained, and this is how silk was discovered in China. Initially, when this silk was discovered, it was kept closed. This concept was not outside the region of China. But slowly and gradually, with the coming in of the navigators, sailors, this idea traveled across the world. So it traveled through the land, it traveled through the waters, but mainly it was through the land. And this route became famous as Silk Route. So this Silk Route basically carried silk from China to the parts of Europe. And the trading of silk began. And this trading was important for the people thriving in the regions of China, and it gave good businesses to Chinese people in European nations. So that was the sole idea how silk evolved. Now the practice of rearing silkworms is known as sericulture. How does this happen? You have the male and the female silkworms that are there. The female lays the egg, and these eggs are collected. So when we talk about artificial rearing, or when we talk about cultivation of silkworms, these eggs are collected, and when they are collected in a tray, you have the numerous eggs which are kept along with chopped pieces of mulberry leaves. Slowly and gradually, when these eggs hatch out and you have the caterpillars that come out, they start to feed on these pieces of mulberry. When these caterpillars are feeding on the pieces of mulberry, they grow in size, and slowly and gradually they start to release a thread that winds around their body in an eight-shaped fashion, and this eight-shaped fashion ultimately turns out to be a cocoon. So cocoon usually has a shiny, lustrous, elastic surface, and from this cocoon you have the silk threads that are derived. This cocoon is very hard, made up of pure protein, and when it is boiled, so either it is put into steam or boiled, then you have the fibers that are separated from the cocoon. So larva, as we said, are kept in the tray. You have the caterpillars that hatch out, which feed on the mulberry for 25 to 30 days, and finally move on to the side where you have the sheds, and within the sheds they start to develop the cocoon. So you have the diagram here that would help you explain better. You have a mulberry tree, you have the female silkworm with the eggs that have been laid down. Then you have from the mulberry tree, the larva that hatches out feeds on the mulberry leaves, and finally you have the cocoon formation. So this cocoon formation is the most important process in the whole of the silk industry or the silkworm industry. Now in India, the most common variety that is found is known as mulberry silk moth. Besides that, you have numerous variety of silk that is found. The commonly found varieties are Muga, Kosa, Eri. So these are some of the common varieties of silk threads that are formed. Now when the cocoons break out, you have the threads that is obtained from the cocoon, and these fine threads which are obtained from the cocoon are obtained through the process which is known as reeling. So that is known as reeling of silk. And finally, this silk is woven. Now when you are weaving, what happens is you have, let's say, four threads here. The next thread that you would weave would be one up, the other from the downward side of the front thread, upside and the downside. And similarly, you would have all the threads that would go into this fashion. And finally, a cloth would be weaved. So that's the most common way of weaving. Now, as we said, silk can be both artificial and natural. So natural silk, if you burn it, you can clearly understand the difference between a natural silk and an artificial silk. So with this, we cover our third lecture on science. We'll be continuing our science lectures in the upcoming classes. Stay tuned, we'll bring in more interesting lectures for science. Have a very good day ahead and do subscribe to the channel.